Let us see how partitions work within Spark. As we discussed earlier, Spark is going to work in a distributed environment where it is going to have n number of worker machines. Any data that it's going to read, it's going to break that into pieces, distribute across multiple machines, and get the processing done in parallel. And the piece of work that we have on the piece of data that is being done or processed in each worker machine, we call that as a partition. And the partitions can exist within a single machine as well. I can partition the data into multiple partitions in a single machine as well. When there are n number of core available within a single machine, it can support parallel processing within a same machine, and it can handle multiple partitions. Partitions are nothing but a collection of rows in a single machine, and it's going to leverage the low-level API or the high-level API, and we can increase or decrease the partitions. Many times, Spark is going to infer the partition from the underlying system. Simple example, let's take. If I have a file of 200 MB, when it is getting stored within the Hadoop distributed file system, that is HDFS2, it would get stored as two partitions or two blocks. When Spark reading it, it's going to read that as two partitions. And if a particular system is having four core processor, and if I'm going to start the Spark processing engine or a Spark shell, it's going to consider four partitions so that it can maximize the utilization of any resource available for the Spark to work. So either it can be controlled with the API, that is the number of partitions I can control, or it can infer from the underlying system, the physical infrastructure, or how the data have been distributed across multiple machines. Let's see a small example. I'm going to get into the Spark shell. I'm opening the Spark shell in a single machine so that it can get started in the local mode. And this machine is having four core processor. Let's read a small file and see how things are going to work. So I'm going to read a file which is available locally in this particular machine. I have a file called online-retail.csv. It's having a header, and I'm going to allow the system to infer the schema automatically. And I'm going to get a data frame. It will infer the schema automatically based on the header that I have, the type, and how many fields I have. I can get the schema using print schema method of a data frame. Retail DF, that's the data frame, dot print schema. So this is the schema that I have. I can get how many partitions this particular data is divided into. I can get with the command retail df, that's data frame dot rdd dot get num partitions. So there are four partitions because I have four core processor in this particular machine. I can get into the web UI of the Spark shell. So I'm running in this particular machine, and the web UI runs in the port 4040. Here I can check it read this particular file using four partitions. Four tasks happened. So this particular CSV file is read with four different partitions. So each partition, how much amount of data it consumed and how many records it is processing, all those informations we can get from this particular web UI. And this particular machine is having a four core processor. So it has four core processor. So it's going to maximize the utilization of the resources and read this particular file with four different tasks. I can control the number of partitions. So let me change the number of partitions. Let me create a new data frame. I'm going to repartition it with 10 different partitions. And I'm going to do the processing on this particular data frame. And one more thing, at this point, I have to reiterate, data frames or immutable. Any data structure that I have within Spark is immutable. Whether it is data frame, data set, or RDD, they are immutable. In the sense, once it is created, it cannot be changed or edited. To create a new structure, or if I want to make any change, I have to create a new data structure and I have to use the process of transformations and actions. And Spark going to choose the optimal way to transform, and for that we will be learning about a process called transformations and action very soon. So let's create a new data frame. So this is the data frame and it's going to get repartitioned with 10 different partitions. If you observe very carefully, I had issued the command repartition, but this particular data frame is not yet created. That means data frames are lazy. It will get created only if there is a need for it. Otherwise, it will not get created. It's going to follow the lazy initiation process. Let me do a simple action against it. I'm going to count how many rows available within this particular data frame. Only then it will go ahead and do the action and it will do the processing. The existence of this particular data frame will come into picture. So here, the count job happened. The count job happened with 10 different tasks. So initial 4 tasks to read the data. So it needs to read the file with the 4 tasks and it's going to automatically optimize. There is a optimizer internally going to find the optimal way to achieve that particular result. And this particular count process is done with 10 different tasks because we partitioned the data with 10 different partitions. This event timeline going to give a valuable information. Resource wise, we have only 4 core processor. So at any point of time, only 4 tasks can happen. But we have the data as 10 partitions. So 10 different tasks has to process the data. At any point of time, if you look at the timeline, only 4 jobs have been processed. And only after one task gets processed, the processing of any task gets over, the next job processing will get started. The green is the processing time. And the red one is the deserialization time, where it is going to read the data from the source. So this is another valuable information. Even though I have partitioned the data into 10 different partitions, I don't have the resources to do the processing in parallel. So when we are controlling the partitions using a low level or high level API, it is more important to understand how much resources we have for that particular job to do the processing. Too much number of partitions also going to kill the processing time in terms of coordination it has to do. So most of the time we will allow the system to infer the optimal value on the number of partitions.